It says, you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood. Look back to chapter 5. It says, it's talking about the priesthood. And there it says, a holy priesthood. It's the priesthood that we are involved with in Jesus, with Jesus, is described in two ways in this passage of Scripture. We are referred to as a holy priesthood. We are also referred to as a royal priesthood. But I want you to notice the fact in verse 9 where he starts off, but you are a chosen race. We are chosen. You know, when I read this, it almost sounds like he's talking about Israel, doesn't it? I mean, because the Bible teaches us that Israel was God's chosen people. Remember the story of Abraham. He made a covenant with Abraham. And he told Abraham that you will be my people forever. When Jesus came and the Messiah arrived and the fulfillment of prophecy in God's eternal plan for salvation for everyone, now the church is the chosen people of God because the Hebrews rejected Christ. We have embraced Christ, and so Peter is referring to us as a chosen people, a royal priesthood unto God. Now, you know, a lot of times we read this stuff and we think, okay, so what am I supposed to do about that? You know, I mean, do I come to church in robes and practice priesthood somehow? No, it's a state of who we are in Christ. And we stand for all the holy things that the ancient priest in Israel stood for. Remember Moses? Who was his brother? Aaron. Aaron was with Moses, and Aaron was the very first priest of Israel. And his lineage, down through the years, down through the ages, down through the millennium, has been the priests of Israel, even unto this day. If there was a temple, and if Israel was still offering blood sacrifice at the temple, still today, the only ones that could do that would be descendants of Aaron, the tribe of Levi. Because that's what the Bible says, only they will deal with those things. By the way, very interesting thing occurred a few years ago. I was reading in, I can't even remember where I was reading. And you know how it is sometimes, you read things, you forget where. If I kept notes on every place I read something, I'd be carrying around a lot of books. But I read this, and so I sent for the paper because I wanted to see it. This scientist who works with DNA, and he is still alive today. He was a Jew. He is a Jew of the tribe of Levi. And he was traveling, and he had gone to Canada. And while he was in Canada, went to temple on the Sabbath. And his last name was Cohen, and Cohen is a Levitical name. Okay, this guy was fair skin, light hair, and looked just like we do, most of us. Well, excuse me, Angel, I'm sorry. Excuse me. Anyway, so when he went to temple, the man leading, the president of the temple that was leading the service, his name was Cohen too, and of course, he was Levitical. He was a Levite. But he looked like an Arab. Dark hair, dark skin, large nose, thick lips, just, you know, a typical Mid-Eastern Arab. And I'm not trying to be ethnic about this at all. I'm just explaining because this is very important in the story. And so the scientist was curious about this. And he said, he was thinking to himself, how is it that we are all Levites, but we are so different? When the Lord comes again, or when things start to happen at the end of the age, how are they going to know who is a genuine Levi and who is not to be able to perform the sacrifices at the temple? And you say, what temple? Well, the Bible tells us, and you can read it in 1 Thessalonians, that there is going to be a temple built.
Yeah. Amen.
In the last days.
Amen.
And so he began examining this issue. Guess what he found out? That in the tribe of Levi, there is a DNA chromosome that only the Levites have. Is that amazing?
Amen.
Only them. So it doesn't matter whether you're dark-skinned or light-skinned, light-hair, dark-hair. It doesn't matter. If you've got the Levitical chromosome, you are a Levite. Is that amazing? Is that God?
Amen.
I mean, who else but God would be able to do something like this that we wouldn't even find out for thousands of years? Is that amazing? Anyway, because every time I read this thing about the priesthood of the believer, the holy priesthood, the royal priesthood, I think of myself, well, you know, how do I know that I am really a priest unto God in this? Well, is it with us? Does it depend on a chromosome? DNA? No, the condition of our heart.
Amen.
Jesus is in our heart. We are believers. We have been filled with the Holy Spirit. And God is working with us in that way. That is our identification to God, that we are believers and we have embraced the person of Jesus Christ and all that has been said about him. Now, I want you to listen to this too. In John chapter 15, verse 16, this verse is very apropos because it says, John is saying, you did not choose me. And he's writing something that Jesus said. Jesus said this. You did not choose me, but I chose you. But you know what? I've always thought that when I was a little boy, I received Christ when I was 7 years old. And I can remember it as vividly as that day. I was sitting on the front porch of our house, and my mom came out and sat down with me. And she says, Dow Jr., she says, are you ready to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior? I already knew what I had to do, but I'd never done it. And my mom said, I'll pray with you if you think you're ready. And I said, well, Mom, I think I am ready. And we went in my bedroom, and we knelt by my bed, and we prayed together, and my mom helped me and led me to receive and invite Jesus into my heart. I remember that as vividly as if it were yesterday. Now, I wish I could tell you, ever since that day, I've been a good boy and a good man, and I've never done anything wrong all my life. You'd probably run me out of town if I claimed that. Because we all know that it isn't true of any of us. But now we are forgiven. We are covered by the blood of Jesus. And it takes care of all sin, past, present, and future. And so as we stand before God, in whatever capacity we stand before him in, even if it's on our knees praying, we represent the priesthood of the believer based upon our relationship with Jesus. Anyway, Jesus goes on in this verse, you did not choose me, but I chose you. And I was saying, gosh, I thought on that day, I chose Jesus. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, before the foundation of time, God already chose me. If you are a believer, God already chose you. Before you were even born, before you were even in your mother's womb, Jeremiah says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain, so that whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he may give to you. What are we supposed to do?
Ask.
Bear fruit. Are we supposed to be preachers? Not necessarily. Are we supposed to be teachers? Not necessarily. Are we supposed to be missionaries? Not necessarily. We have been chosen as priests unto God to represent him in whatever capacity he leads us to, and to bear fruit.
Amen.
To the glory of God. You know what bearing fruit is? Name a fruit we're supposed to bear.
Love.
Love. Another one.
Joy.
Joy. What else?
Peace.
Vicky? Hope. Patience. What else?
Long-suffering.
Long-suffering. What else? What was it?
Kindness.
Kindness. Goodness. And Corinthians 2. But Paul literally lists them, and that's the fruit that God wants us to bear. We are to be a special, unique people, doing things that the rest of the world doesn't do, acting in a way that the rest of the world doesn't act, speaking in a way that the rest of the world doesn't speak. We are called and chosen into this priesthood environment to bear the fruit to the glory of God. He chose us. We didn't choose him. And it reminds us that God loves us and wants only the best for us. How do we know? Because he chose us. Look back at verse 4 for just a moment. That we are precious in the sight of God. You are precious in the sight of God. He has joy when he looks upon you. He has joy when he hears you pray. He looks upon us and he looks at me and he shakes his head. He says, I don't know about DJ, but the rest of you are doing pretty good. But I mean, we're precious, just like my little grandson. He is precious to me in a way that I can't even describe. Now, I took care of him yesterday morning, and he got a little behind cattle once or twice for doing something he knew he wasn't supposed to do. Just a little swat. He thought, you'd think he'd been snake bit. But we're the same way. God has to paddle us once in a while, doesn't he? Does God have to deal with some things in our life from time to time? But he loves us because we're precious to him. We've been chosen by him, and we're precious. And so he closes this little section of scripture. For you once were not a people. We weren't a people like God. I mean, we've got Irishmen here, and Scotsmen here, and Hispanic here. We've got Dutch people here, and God knows what all we've got here. But as the people of God, we're God's people. But you were once not a people, but now you are the people of God. And have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. And folks, that's what I need a lot of, is mercy. That's what you need a lot of, is mercy. Do we want what we've got coming?
No.
No way. I don't want what I've got coming. I want mercy. I want grace. I want forgiveness. And I've found that in the person of Jesus Christ. As we partake of the Lord's Supper today, the reason it's so important to us, the reason we do it several times a year in our church, because it symbolizes the price that Christ paid for our sin. We take of the cup, which symbolizes his shed blood. We partake of the bread, which symbolizes his broken body. And all of these things we've been talking about in this Bible study this morning and in others over the months and everything, all brings us again to the same reminder. You have grace and mercy and forgiveness in Christ. And this is a reminder of why. This morning, we're going to continue in a moment. Do we have some special music, Todd?